once that gets going, we'll record ours and we will get started. Okay, that is live. So let me shut that off so I don't have to hear it. Okay. All right, I'm going to start our recording here and then I'm going to mute everybody. And if you have anything that you want to say, then certainly speak up. There we go, record, record to the computer. Here we go. Mute all. And again, like last week, there were just under 300 people signed up for this. So I'll be letting people in throughout the course of this. The entire Zoom, other than this part, is going to be presented within the app. I've been working using the app so much more. I have to be honest, it's changing the way I'm doing private lessons to a point that I think it's the most effective teaching I've done. I think it's very, very similar to some of the things I did in the Endless Pool, but it's more practical application where athletes get to try different things immediately to see whether or not they work. And as a teacher and a coach, one of the most exciting things is to, I go through a series of questions after someone finishes a swim. And the questions are, what did it feel like? Was it harder or easier? What was the effort level in compared to the other? You know, so try to, you know, if we put heart rate monitors on, it'd be really cool. And then was it faster or slower? And so you have these series of questions that you ask before you show them any of the data or show them how they did. And one of the athletes I'm going to show you here today was the best look that you could expect as a teacher, that when you tell them the results of what they did, the look of shock on their face, because they can't comprehend that they just went so much faster by doing less. And that's really what breaststroke is all about. I've said it 1,000 times to people, less is more on breaststroke. And the more we try, a lot of the times, the slower they go. So Dan is asking, are these over the internet or in-person, the lessons? So this was an incredible weekend. I had in-person lessons at Northwestern. And all the while, I had swimmers that I have coached and taught out in Arizona at a meet. And so all weekend long, parents were uploading the races into the app. They were showing up live on my iPad. I was doing an evaluation in between prelims and finals, and the kids were making adaptations during in between that time. In one case, I got the video in while the swimmer was in the warm down pool and was making some suggestions. And in fact, I think we might have gotten all the marketing quotes that we needed this past weekend from parents that were immediately getting the feedback back. And again, this was 2,000 miles away. So what I'm going to show today is, I'm not going to show those races, but I will show part of a lesson and the importance of all of these little details that we're going to go over, and especially mostly in Steve's videos. And so I'll be asking Steve to unmute multiple times through this because this is his content that we created a long time ago. But it's always great to have, what's it called? The horse's mouth? I say that in the kindest way. Okay. So, all right. Okay. So let me get the iPad up and then I'll get my windows all together. I'll get my notes up and then we will get going. Okay. I need participants. I need chat up. And then here we go. More people coming in. Okay. So we're going to start off with body position. So one of the most basic things, but always, I think, one of the most important, because you know, you spend so much time working with students and telling them that, you know, people focus so much on how hard they're pulling or how hard they're kicking. But if the body line isn't taken care of, it doesn't matter. You're just not going to be in the right position to do what you need to do on these things. So we're going to get up to, you know, again, Steve starting from on deck. And so getting the feelings, the movements, the positions all set before the swimmers even get in the water. And so this is the missile position. And so you'll see a thumb lock in here. So getting the hands close together, because we want to make sure that the hands, the arms are inside the shoulders, semi-streamline. But if you go to a streamline position, it's going to be very difficult to initiate a stroke or to build flow or rhythm or rate. So it's important that they have this understanding of just that separation. Let's see really quick. There's a question again. Can I do screen recordings of this short part of the conversation and share with families? I mean, you can do whatever you want. I think the garbage men are coming. Hang on a second. So we're a day off because of President's Day, so I didn't expect them. Okay, so missile position. It's a little bit adapted from the streamline position because the breaststroke initiates with the hands further out. So here we are, the standard streamline position, and the difference is missile position has the hands just a little bit outside of that. One of the drills I like to do is to have people do breaststroke thumb lock and then get used to having the thumbs cantilever and pull the elbows in so that the line is good. And then they have to do that. They will release the thumbs and try to keep the arms in that spot. But this position right here, and you've heard me say it multiple times before about the intensity of technique. And so the line that you have here from top to bottom, this is not as easy as people think. And so demonstrating to the swimmers this the straightness of the body and thinking of that underwater is so incredibly important. So teaching the line and teaching the, you know, almost like standing at attention in this position to really get that idea. So we go forward to about the 46 second mark. And so here it is. It's the same thing that she just did, only she's underwater. So we want to teach them and then have them apply the same position underwater. Now, when they get their body in position, and this is really so much of breaststroke and teaching breaststroke, is that the effort that it takes to move forward when you're balanced and in line is almost nothing. So Steve was basically going to take her, get her in the position, and then throw her like a dart, and she just travels down the pool. So this is what we want for people, is that ability to maintain velocity, maintain momentum. And when most people are trying to get to the next stroke, the smart people are just laying there and doing nothing. So again, throw them like a dart. It's just such an easy sort of thing, and especially to get across to little kids. Let me look at my notes really quick because it's a 56 second mark. I want to make sure I didn't miss this, because this, I think, is very important. Okay, this is it. So it doesn't look like much, but I'm telling you, it's huge. So if you look at her, the position of her arms right now. So if you looked at it directly from the side, we'd see this up and down sort of position. And so it's not that she's standing straight. It's like there's a bend right here. And so watch the subtle thing that Steve does to make sure that she's in the right position. Watch how he takes her arms and lift them up. So this movement right here to there changes the entire profile of the swimmer on the water. So now the hands are going to pierce through the water. They're not pushing through. In this position, you've got water hitting on the back of them. And so by fixing that right there, that little movement right there changes the whole dynamic. So when I talk about the intensity of teaching, the intensity of technique, this is what I'm talking about. It's you know, when I hear coaches say, well, we do these drills, but how do you do them? How do you do them? Because the kids will imprint the wrong things if you don't take the time to make sure that they understand what they're doing and they understand why they're doing it. Very, very important. So here's another one. Watch this. So look at this position right here. And now watch. Get the chin off the chest. So just extend that a little bit so that you're not curling over. Remember, this area right here is really an area that you have to spend a lot of time focusing on, because the torso is going to be down. It'll come up to the shoulders and the arms want to go down. So if he gets her to extend the neck a little bit, that actually pulls the arms back a little bit and the line becomes cleaner. So all of these little front end adjustments that you see Steve making in this, it's so important that don't overlook those details. That's the big thing. Don't overlook those details, because that is the line. And if it's not right, then it's not right. I mean, that's technical for you. Yes,
I probably had to. I probably had to go underwater to really see that.
Even to the point here, Steve, what do you see?
Sorry, what do I see?
So there, you'd probably, knowing you, you would look at this. If you were underwater, you would go and make that correction that the arms are slightly down in the frame.
Yeah, I bring that up a little bit, but still keep the fingertips down.
Yep. So, and then the last part of this is right there.
So, I like that.
Yeah, it's beautiful, isn't it? Those are so good. I love the toe point at the end. And then we're going to go all the way to up here a little bit. And so right here, make the smallest hole possible. And so this is going to continue to travel forward. Steve, what else do you have on this one?
No, I don't know. I might get our arms up a little bit, fingertips down.
And I think right here, you can see that, you know, she does get relaxed. But this is the nature of dealing with little kids, isn't it?
Yeah, she's 7 or 8.
Not bad. Not bad. To learn this, you know, imagine, I mean, so this is all these little subtle things. When you've been teaching a long time, when you see her coming here like this, and then the body starting to pivot across, so she's moving sideways at this point. I love that she was so committed to staying in the line. Most people are going to try to fix that. But the most important thing there, and what Steve has taught her, is that maintain this position. Maintain the position. Don't worry about what anything else that's going on at that point. Maintain that position. So fantastic job, as always. Okay. This one has about 500 points to it. So we're going to try to get through it as quickly as possible. So we might skip through some of them because we could spend the entire rest of the hour just on breaststroke kick. So we'll go through this pretty quickly. So Steve does get started again on land. Let's see. So we start with point, and Steve, you're the master of mantras. And so I've gotten so many mantras from Steve, and you'll hear a bunch today. So Steve, do you want to say what each one is, or putting you on the spot?
No, I'm just telling them to point or flex.
Yep. So it's point.
Flex.
And
turn out.
Uh-huh. And then the last one?
Point.
Circle and point.
We make circles just to get them aware of their feet.
There he goes. So again, it starts very small, but at the same time, these movements are very hard to teach in the water if the kids don't understand them. Look at the look on her face. I love this. She's looking over here, seeing what he's doing. She's looking at the other girls, and she's mimicking. Look at her looking around. Now, these two kind of already know. They're a little bit older, but look at the little one. And so that engagement and that mimicking process is so important for little kids. Can you imagine if you just put her in the water and tried to teach her this? Well, she's more worried about whether or not she's going to get a breath. So up here on land, she's getting this feeling. And this position right here, she's going to activate her shins. So she's going to feel that. She feels that stretch. We have to remember breaststroke is the only one that kicks with the inside of the foot, whereas all the other ones are the bottom and the top. And so it's totally foreign to little kids or people that have just started to swim breaststroke. So this is just such a great exercise. Just fantastic. And then put her on her back and see the model. Now, again, we're going to go through some of this stuff. So then simply sit them on the side of the pool. And we've got the same exercise here. So it's point, where are we at? Let me look at my notes. Okay, feet flat on the surface of the water. And then back down to bring the heels back to the wall. Heels back to the wall. Look at my notes. So the feet are slightly apart. Back to the point, back to here, and then we're going to get into the flex. Now, we're going to look at this in a minute from straight down, and I'm going to talk about the hydrodynamic position of breaststroke. So this position right here, the feet are a little bit wider, so they'd be outside the shoulders, whereas the knees are going to be inside So inside the shoulders. So this is a great position to push water back. All right. So, and we'll talk about that in a second, as far as the narrowness or the wideness, if that's a word. So narrow or wide in the breaststroke kick. And so here she is in this position, 130. Look at my notes really quick. So pivot out 137. So again, from here out, and then circle back to the front and see, this is a typical, so you can see what happened here while we were filming this. She finished it. She didn't finish it. She went right into the next one. And I guarantee you, from above the water, Steve said, point your toes. Okay. So she came in and finished and then went on to the next one. But then she knew that she wasn't done. So she had to redo it again. And so always finishing each one to the point right there. And she gets better at it as she goes along. So again, not asking her to do full stroke, breaststroke, but actually just finishing this or initiating this process on the surface. Look at that. Now we're really focusing. So she's got the whole thing put together. And then she finishes it with a very thoughtful point of the toes at the end, because the breaststroke kick isn't done until the toes are absolutely pointed. Okay.
And she was a little wide in the beginning, but she got better as we went along.
I think so as well. So Steve, explain right here as far as the pressure that you're putting on the feet.
That's what I want. I want them to feel. I want them to feel the, I want their feet to be in a position that I can feel the pressure on my hand, and then I let it go.
So if you watch really subtly how he puts the thumb on the inside and then turns the feet out just a little bit. And that again is, this is not necessarily a natural position for the feet to be in. So by directing that a little bit, they get more of a sense of that kinesthetic awareness of what it's supposed to feel like.
I give her the flex and I give her some torque in her foot.
Mm-hmm.
And the non-breaststrokers really need to feel that.
Yeah. So let's see where we are, 219. Yeah, practice some small kicks. And then one of my favorite drills all time is this one right here, in which you're now starting to try to teach the recovery of the feet or the feet behind the body. And it's a little difficult for some of the younger kids. So this is a great exercise that you want to make sure that the board is held as much as possible over the knees so that the knees don't come up and hit the board. And so the recovery is done back behind there. Depending on the athlete, let me get this back to here. Depending on the athlete, I might have them turn the board sideways so that it's a little bit thicker so that they hit it. But again, it's all going to be based on who you're working with at the time. So great, great exercise. Very simple. Still have people coming in. So again, watch the feet, the turn right there. So the turn of the feet, very, very important. Let's see if there's more questions coming in. Okay, we're good. All right, 230, 301. So I'm going to jump forward. So I'm just looking because there was so much on this. So again, practicing, and then 317. Show the heels coming up. Okay, here we go. So at 317, right here. So you can see here that there's a tuck, all right? And so when you're first teaching, before we get into all the real specific details, this line is also one that we always want to think about, is how much resistance are we creating in order to set up the kick? And so rather than getting into this line, what we're trying to do is bring the heels up behind a little bit more. Now, when you're flat on the surface of the water, like these swimmers are, you can't avoid this, because if you're flat on the surface and you recover your heels up, where are they going to be? They're going to be out of the water. And so, you know, we don't want to get too focused on this position, because this exercise is about waking up the feet and kind of the movement of the feet. So the next phase here is, this is the breaststroke recovery, which is the heels up. You draw the heels up, not necessarily tucking the knees up. Because the knees will create a little bit more resistance. So the recovery of the feet happens behind and is hidden by the thighs as much as possible to make sure that we create as little resistance as possible. So Here he's going to go ahead and get it into that position. And here comes the breaststroke position. This is the one that, you know, the party trick is being in this position. So I haven't done it for a year now, but I can sit in this position and stand up from there. Because if you're a breaststroker, this is actually a comfortable position for you. If you're not a breaststroker, this is not a comfortable position for you. And
the
so
key for the teacher to do this, they got to put that thumb on the big toe and have their fingers on top of the foot and give it a real crank there. You have to hold it exactly like that. And I work with my instructors to learn how to do this. And it's amazing how sometimes they just don't get it until I really help them get into this position.
Again, it's not a natural position for people to be in. And so helping someone understand and realize that is very important. We do also have a whole video by Steve on how to hold people, how to manipulate, you know, the positioning, where to stand, how to stand. And so there's a lot of thought that goes into this. Okay. So 417. So it's just coming up right here. So it should be going straight down. Okay. So when you have little kids, you know, and a lot of, you know, the old teaching is up, out, together. So it would be up, feet go out, they go around, and then they come together. So it's kind of like this, you know, the circular sort of fashion. Modern breaststroke is more of a linear, everything in swimming anymore is more linear. And so if we look at the way that Steve is teaching her how to move the feet, it's not going out. But once she gets into this position, the feet are going directly back. And so it's a direct line back, almost like she's stomping down on the insides of the feet. So this is just tremendous. So remember I talked about, I'm going to show the hydrodynamic positioning. So if we go back a little bit and we remember how the legs were recovered by bringing the heels up behind the thighs. So recovering the legs behind the thighs. So if we come up to this position, and a lot of times we've been teaching such a narrow kick for so long, if the feet are inside even more than what they are now, because we want this smaller kick, then all the water that's coming back from the body right here, this is all disrupted. Okay. So it's being pulled forward. And so that's what I call dirty water. All right. But the clean water is outside of the shadow of the body. So as the feet come up, you know, let me see if we got it. So now it's just here. So if the feet were up and then they get outside this, they're going to be pressing on still water straight back. This is a beautiful kick. This is a beautiful kick because, again, the water that's behind the body is being drawn forward. And so outside here, you got this clean water. And you're pushing back on that. And so it's just beautiful. This is the sort of kick that I like to teach. I call it narrow wide. It's narrow recovery and wide on the way back. And if you have a narrow recovery, you think you're going wide, but you're just getting outside the shadow of the body and you're getting clean water out there. And it's a great pushback. So really, really nice. And when I saw that, I was like, Steve, we shot that so many years ago. And it's just so still exactly what I teach. I hope that doesn't mean that I'm not advancing. I just think it means that it was just really good, even when we shot this, and such a great way to teach people. Let's see, 143. Oh yeah, this was really good. This was really good. Okay. Oh, let's see, where was it? Okay. So this is what I'm talking about. So I'm talking about the bend between the torso and the knees in the setup of the kick. And so when Steve is not helping this athlete along, they go instinctual. They think, I need to set up this big kick. And this is so subtle and going through this and seeing it, I'm like, oh my gosh, that was perfect. So watch, this is a kick without aid. Okay. So we're going to look at the line from the torso to the knee. And so this again is this spot, it's the hip. Now, Steve immediately sees this as a teacher, re-engages. Now, let's watch this line again. Look at that. That's what we're looking for. But you have to be taught that sometimes, you know, and sometimes it does take the manipulation. So look at the difference in the line between this swimmer and this swimmer. So the amount of resistance in comparison to those two kicks, and again, this is someone that's been teaching for so long that this is an instinct that he sees it, he feels it, he fixes it immediately. And that's what I appreciate so much about what Steve does. Look at this. So again, this is going to be more work for this young swimmer. Okay, this is not necessarily a good kick. All right, not horrible, but it can be better. So Steve re-engages, brings the knees back, or brings the calves up and the heels up, and then watch as soon as he lets go again. Boom. She's back to the big kick. And so there, you know, this is going to be continued work with this young athlete. But again, there's that hope that she's going to get it. And this is actually not too bad. Maybe just slightly wide, but when we look at the line, it's not that bad. So all right, that's the kick. Steve, do you have anything else on the kick?
No.
Can I ask a question about the kick, what Steve just did?
Only if it's funny.
Steve, how were you manipulating in terms of, were you pulling up on her knees or just bending the bottom of her legs forward?
I was just controlling the position of the knees. So I guess I was keeping them a little more narrow and keeping them up, so they wouldn't, the hip flexors wouldn't drop the knees down.
It is so much to do with the hand and the thumb. You know, like Steve talked about the thumb when he's pointing that out. So controlling part of it and then using the thumb pressure to pivot them in a certain direction. Now, here's the good news is that we're still doing kick, but this is the shortest video ever. And so this really teaches people how to recover with the heels rather than with the knees. So the wall kick is just simply hanging on the wall. And if you're, I'll move forward to the underwater. Okay. So if you're in this position and hanging on the wall and you recover with the knees, so imagine that the torso is going to get, and here's the hips. So if the knees are coming like this, you're just going to slam your feet, your knees into the wall. And so nobody wants to do that. So what do? You recover with the heels. Okay. And so the simplest exercise ever to really teach someone what the recovery of the kick is supposed to be like. And again, we're looking at this nice line from the torso through the hips to the knees, because when we're breathing, we're going to be in this upward orientation, which we're going to see in a couple minutes as we get into the breathing phase of the stroke. But again, this is one of those things, do it slowly, do it thoughtfully, focus on the heels coming up behind you, grab some water, push it back down to the bottom. Simple, 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 but really effective. I think the first time we shot this was Dave and Stacey Anna, back in mid, it had to be 2003, 2004. So 20 years ago, this one, when they're good, they just don't go out of style. They're just good all the time. Thanks, B. I see you're answering that. Appreciate it. Let's see what's next. Who should be on number four? The pole. Okay. So again, there's mantras in this one as far as how to teach someone. We start in the missile position on deck. And then you can always use a noodle. Steve talks about a noodle or a lane line. The big thing about this is how far back are the elbows going to come? And so when people are initially learning breaststroke, they have this feeling of power and they're trying to draw themselves forward. And the reality is the elbows don't go that far back. And from a teaching perspective, when you can always make things bigger, it's really difficult to make things smaller. And so if you can start with a small pole without the elbows going past the shoulders, you are in a better position to move forward. So you're going to see this in a minute. And this will be from one of the lessons this weekend. you know, it was, I really was trying to get this athlete to stop pulling so big. And so I made her do half pulls and I filmed her. And I said, how are your elbows? I'm not going to show you this part, but I said, where were your elbows? And she said, well, I think they were probably in front of my shoulders. They were literally that far behind her shoulders. She didn't move them at all. It's this feeling that you have. And so sometimes you have to see it before you understand that you really haven't made any change. But it's just like such a small thing. That's why video becomes so important if you're teaching, because I'm telling you, they don't know what they're doing. They have no idea. What they feel is not what's happening. And so if you don't show them, then you're just going to be fighting against yourself, because they're not going to make the changes typically, unless you're a lot better teacher than I am. But I cheat that. I just use video all the time. So great head position, head down in the water. Here's that line again. So really teaching that. So, Steve likes to have the hands right on the surface of the water. So here we go at 34. Okay. So it's I. So if we want to get into the mantra, it's I. It's Y. So get into a Y position with the arms. So, and this is where Monty started our friendship in the question, if there is no resistance on the out sweep, why don't the hands just slice out, which I have been playing with ever since. And so again, you can see how Steve, I don't think we're not even thinking about that at this point, but the hands don't necessarily give a lot of pressure on the way out. You can see their position sideways. So really cool from that standpoint. So I, Y. Let's see. Then we get into the vertical forearm. So this is EVF. This is the early vertical forearm for breaststroke. And you can see that there's no way she can bring the top part of the arm down. So she has to pivot this down and into this position, which is where you want to be. So it's a Y position with the hands down. And I've done this before. And Steve, I think you've done it where the swimmer has to place their hands directly on the wall and feel that. Yep. Get a head shake. Go ahead.
Yes. I'll have them do that, and I'll have them scrape the wall, and then we do it without touching the wall, but almost. And so I don't know what I do on this video right now, though.
Yeah, this, we just keep them off the wall right here. So it's I, Y, this is the scoop. And so he starts to bring the hands in slightly. And so teaching that inward motion. So I, Y, scoop, which is in, and then shoot, which is forward. So I, Y, scoop, and shoot. And so very small motion, very small movement, but it becomes very dynamic when they get into the water. So I, Y, scoop, and shoot. Great, great little mantra to keep in mind. Let's see, 130. So when they start to practice it, make sure they're doing it very slowly. So we'll get it to the pool here. So here she is doing it on her own. Soft out. Boom. And so again, by having this very controlled situation with a young kid that doesn't have to worry about moving forward or breathing or balancing or any of that stuff, she's starting to develop the internal understanding of how the hands are supposed to move in breaststroke. So fantastic. Let's go up to 228. So we're going to get into the missle position. So again, you're going to see this in the last video today. Always review a step before you move to the next step. Even if you're working on a step, make sure that they understand the process. So there's a review that goes on. So back to the missle position before she does anything else. And then, so it's I, Y, and now we're getting into the scoop, which is the EVF or the vertical forearm position. So out and now scoop and then shoot back forward. So look at that. I mean, that understanding where that is so important. The head position is down when she's at this position. This is going to become very important when we go to the breath. So this is just fantastic. And I love teaching it in that stagnant position right there. And then again, helping her understand the movements and then allowing her to do the movements on her own. Oh, and always, always, always end up like that. Always, I think that when you're working with someone that's newer to the sport, you have to put all the focus on the line. So everything gets back to here. Nothing is done until you're back to here. Then you can start everything over again. If we just rush from one pole to the next, we don't get the we don't get everything that we need to out of each stroke. So here it is, IY scoop, or just there it is. It happens so fast.
Yeah, she could, by not breathing, she can see her scoop coming towards her eyes, and then she's also over a mirror.
That's what I was going to say. So most of this teaching is done over mirrors. So she is watching the shape of what she's doing right now. And again, if you don't have mirrors, film a lot. There we go. Very small. And we notice that the elbows barely, if at all, get past the shoulders. And this is still a, is this a non-breath? She might have grabbed a breath, but man, not much, because we're going to get into that next. So here's the mirrors underwater. And I'm telling you, it totally changes the way people understand what they're doing. So look at her eyes, still down, and then back to there. And again, no kick yet at this point. All right. So now we're on to timing. One of my favorite things to teach. And the drill is just so standard, but how you do it is very, very important. So always understanding that the stroke isn't done until we get back to here. So making sure that we finish with a complete stroke, which means that the hands and the legs and the eyes are all in this position. So the arms are fully extended, the legs are fully extended, and the kick is finished. The eyes are down, just like the first position that we worked on in body position with the athletes standing up. We've got the missile position right there. So this is a complete stroke of breaststroke. Without this, it just doesn't matter all the other stuff that's going on. So we have to finish each stroke. All right. So 21, we can start the process by looking at thumb lock, because that's going to slow them down a little bit, because there's an extra step in there. So it makes them think about, they have to complete something. So that's why I love thumb lock in teaching. Let's see, 25, be patient and spend more time in the line is what I wrote down. Look at that. Look at that. She's going to continue to move forward. She can decide when to take the next stroke. This is just, I mean, hydrodynamically, this is unbelievable. This is so beautiful. She is not engaged with the surface of the water. Her head's in this great position. Look how straight the lines are. Her arms are. Look how straight the legs are. I mean, this is just fantastic. So this is the image that everybody needs to have in between every stroke of breaststroke. You've got to get to here. Now, again, understanding that this week we're talking about teaching breaststroke. If you're talking about Adam Peaty or some of the top male sprinters, they're not going to reach this position on a 50 breast. It was funny, during world championships, I got a text from a buddy of mine who said that he watched the 50 breaststroke, and the guy that ended up winning or second, is he immediately took his cap off and his hair was completely dry. And he said, how did he do that? And I said, well, first of all, the only time it's going to be completely underwater is during the underwater pole. So he's going to be having so much velocity, the water's going to have a hard time catching back up. He probably had two caps on, and when he's swimming, his head barely goes underwater. And he said, I got it. You know, because really in 26 seconds in a 50 breaststroke, if you've got two caps on and you're popping right on the surface every time, your head's not going to go very far underwater at all, and your hair is probably not going to get wet. That's our goal, is to not get our hair wet in swimming. Then you know you're really fast. So, or you have horrible body position and your head's out of water every time. Okay, this is the goal. Whenever I do video evaluations on people, this is the one of the telltale things. This is about timing and breaststroke. And this is about, okay, what are you looking for? And I have my standard mantra that I say all the time in the timing of breaststroke. The front of the body needs to be ready to accept the propulsion that the feet are about to deliver. And so what does that mean? That means that the hands are extended, the eyes are down, and the feet are just getting ready to engage in that press. If you're still coming down and the feet are pushing back, I call that a push me, pull me, and you're basically trying to extend while the feet are going the other direction. The crazy thing is, that's how I was taught to swim breaststroke. Kick the hands forward. Okay, a lot of us were taught kick the hands forward. The hand should already be forward before the kick comes in. Okay. So let's watch this again. So shooting forward, head is down. The feet have still not finished their recovery. She is down in position and she's back to that line that I just praised so much on the other one. And now that feet, those feet are going to drive her forward. Look at that. Just beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. So how do we get that? So separation drill is where you take a pole and you'll notice that she's not breathing at this point. So again, whether she's over a mirror, she's understanding, she's got the system. So it's a pole with no breath, back to the line, and then a kick. And then a pole, maybe a breath. I don't think there's breathing yet on this one. And then back to, so everything, it's the definition of the drill. It's separated. Everything is separated. The pole is separated, then the kick is separated. One of the things that you'll see, and we'll see it in her just a little bit, when you're doing this as a teacher, try to keep the legs as rigid as possible. What will generally happen is that as she goes forward, she doesn't do it here, but she does it on one of the other ones, is when they go forward here, they're going to do a dolphin kick right there. If they do a dolphin kick, they're still engaging the mind into thinking that the legs are sending the front forward. So you want to make sure that they don't do that. You want to keep the legs as rigid as possible. So these are really good right here. I think this one, no, that was pretty good too. Okay, so this is a cool thing about separation drill. The cool thing is when they make a mistake, all right? So when they make a mistake, and Steve explained it a little bit differently, I like to call it the mistake, all right? Is that they're trying to do separation drill, but their mind wants them to swim. And so this swimmer watched this perfect separation drill. Boom, great, great. And now the next one, if it's separation drill, look at, she's drawing her feet and then she starts to kick. That's a mistake in separation drill, but it's the perfect breaststroke timing for the swimmer. And so that's what you're going for, is you're trying to bring these together slowly or watch for the mistakes. And so Steve does talk about it in the video that, you know, sometimes you just let them go at this point. So really, really nicely done. Look at, the head is coming down. And so, you know, yeah, I mean, she's just learning this. So maybe it's not absolutely perfect, but that's great timing right there. Really, really good. All
the time. You start with separation drill and they just can't help themselves. Then they do the stroke just right. And I say, okay, that's good.
Just keep doing that one. Yeah, because here she goes. So look at this. Look at this. So after he just kind of let her go on it, let's look at that magic point of where do the feet start to go back? Where is the front of the body? So this is what's really cool about using the GoSwim app. I used to use coaches all the time and did the same thing, but since they're out of business, we're doing it, okay? But you can get so exact on what you're showing someone with this scrub bar and going forward on it. Look at that. So the feet, where do they start to go back? So right there. And so there, you look forward. Is she ready to accept the propulsion the feet are about to give? Absolutely. This is great. This is absolutely great. Love it. And this is what separation drill can give you if you're patient enough in the process of it. So just fantastic. Love that, Steve. All right. This is a big one as well. Looking at the time, 12:44. We're doing okay. All right. So breathing. If you watch normal people swim breaststroke, they usually start the head lift when the hands start to separate. And so the people will do this all the time. And unfortunately, that's not how you breathe in breaststroke. And so what Steve is teaching you here is that the breath happens as you come in. All right. And so I like to call it in and up to breath. And so we all have our ways of saying it. And so the first thing that Steve does is he has the swimmers do some swimming without breathing. Now, you'll look at someone bigger. I remember this guy. He ended up being really fast, didn't he, Steve? I forget who he swam for, but you're silenced.
Then got injured.
What's that?
He swam at Stanford 1 year and polo, but then he got injured. He went 53
in high school, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
You broke up for a minute there. So I wanted to confirm that, but it's 53 in breaststroke in high school. Okay. So even if this was non-breath, because we were working on non-breath, his head is going above the surface of the water. Okay. So this is really moving forward on it. And then right here. So what Steve talks about in the video is that he wants the swimmers to understand that by not breathing, there's a rise that occurs. Okay. So this motion right here, this is the one that Rachel still yells at me about. Okay. Being an old breaststroker, that she says, keep your head down. What's wrong with you? Well, remember back in the day, our head wasn't allowed to go underwater. So this is all new to me. So the idea here is that the head stays down till it's wide, till the arm's widest point. And it was great in the endless pool. And when Steve has mirrors, you basically get the swimmers to watch until their hands are at the widest point, watch in the mirror. And then as soon as the hands are out there, do whatever you want, because on the in sweep, your body's going to come up. And so what Steve does at this point is he says, experience what happens when the arms come in. Okay. When the scoop occurs, there it goes up. And let's look at her, a total non-breathing stroke, and her mouth is less than an inch away from the surface of the water. Total non-breathing stroke. Didn't even plan on breathing. So this is the natural way that the body works. So very, very good. So let's see. Here it is without kicking. So again, on the in sweep is when everything really starts to come up. So she's doing a little dolphin kick right there. But again, the in sweep is when you want everything to come up. Look at my notes. 19, alternate breath and no breath. So head stays down. Now look at the difference between the breath. But this is a no breath. Do you see where she is? And then the next one is the breath. Get head in a very similar position. And so we see this nice straight line between the spine and the head. Now, I will talk a little bit. I think next week when we get on to advanced breaststroke, then we can talk about some alternatives for this. But when you're teaching someone, I do believe that there are very rigid kind of rules that you have as a teacher, that when the kids are young, you hold them to that rules. And then as their physiology starts to change and they start to mature and you see who comes out, that's when you have to specialize. And so there are some variations in this, but when you're teaching, if you do the variations that I'll probably talk about next week, you'll probably mess up the kids. And so so this position here of what we call the straight spine line from the spine up to the top of the head, you want to try to maintain that as much as possible in the teaching pattern. So again, hands out wide and then in and up to air, in and up. Okay, let's see where we are. So 53, maintain the stability going up to air. Okay, so this is Steve, again, teaching someone not to lift your head to air. And so the first one is a non-breathing stroke. And you can almost see that he has to fight her on this, because she wanted to tilt and lift right there. And then the next one, watch the positioning of his hands. Okay, again, so important and experience. So here, almost holding her down a little bit, and then knowing that the next one is going to be a breath, knowing it, he repositions the hands under so he can lift a little bit more, making sure that she gets her air. Okay, so very, very subtle differences. And then teaching her how to do it repetitively and then just letting her go. And then the old tennis ball and the neck trick. Okay. So the idea here is that they have to keep their head in line by holding a tennis ball in their neck to make sure that they don't lift. If they lift too much with this, then what's going to happen is the tennis ball is going to fall out. So the goal here is right there, breathing again in this spine line right here with the tennis ball still in. So very, very good. Now, one of the things that I like to make sure everybody understands in breaststroke is how the whole machine works. And so as she's got her head down, the hands are engaged, they're ready to come in, and we know that the chest is about ready to go up. And so the focus here is really on the hips and the legs. So it's how the setup of the kick is done. And if all the timing is correct and everything is put in line, as she goes up, then the body collapses in a way. I call it the buckle, okay? And so what happens is we just watch her hips on this one. So just watch her hips. As she pulls and goes up, then the hips are going to be drawn forward, okay? And I have filmed, I can't tell you how many people I've filmed in the endless pool and said, okay, when you take your breath, what happens to your hips? And every kid that I asked that to, they said the hips sink. And I said, I'll bet you. Okay. Because we've been taught so much that if the head goes up, the hips are going to fall, that your body is just like this rigid thing, like a teeter totter. All right. These hips don't sink when she does this. The hips are drawn forward because as this comes up, this moves in this direction forward. Horrible arrow there. Watch the hips forward, forward. Okay. So if we get through that top part fast enough, the hips don't necessarily go up and down very much in breaststroke, but they go forward. And then she sets up the kick. And there, you know, there was a little sink right there because she's a young swimmer. So now let's watch the legs. Are the legs drawn by the knees or by the buckle? I love the buckle. And so the legs will naturally break right there. So as the hips come forward, the legs, the feet are floating, the knees start to bend. So right here, they get into this natural position. So this is what I'm looking for when I teach breaststroke, is this line right there. Okay. So it's that smooth line. And again, at this point, we have no angle between the hips. Okay. It's just flat line between the hips. And then look at that. She can bring her. Now, remember what we talked about before. Let me do here. Is the line from the torso to the knees. And then look at her bringing her heels up behind her. She sinks a little bit, but sets up the kick. Look at that. If you had a 10 or 11-year-old doing this, then the only thing to say is congratulations, Steve. Another great job. That is fantastic. We could nitpick little things with it, but the understanding of what's going on here in the future, and again, you guys know, I think, what is this kid going to be 10 years from now or 8 years from now or 6 years from now? Well, with this, she'd be anything she wants. I mean, it's just there's so much already connected that it's just tremendous. All right. And finally, this one's pretty quick. It's basically, this just gets to the point of when you start to teach, just review everything. Okay. So first review the line, then review the kick, then review the pull with no breathing, then review the timing separation drill, then review the breathing, that the head goes up on the in sweep, and then let them start to go. So very, very simple from that standpoint. And there's a map right there. There's a whole map on how to teach breaststroke. So we go all the way back up to the top. So I'm just going to show these really quickly. This was a lesson this weekend. And this was, these are only two 50s of breaststroke that I'm going to show really quick. Okay. And I gave one piece of instruction on the second 50. You can see the data down at the bottom. Looks pretty nice, right? Not so bad. Young female, 14 years old. So I gave one piece of instruction for the second one. And again, the way I do this is I will tell them, I will give them a challenge of what to do. And then when they come back, I ask them all the questions, you know, easier, harder. What did you feel? So basically what we have here is the breakout on the first one was 6.64. The second length was 6.96. So those are underwater pulls. The first 25 was 18.5, 20.5, 8 strokes down, 9 strokes back, time of 39.14. Okay. I will have the comparison of it in a second. So here's the second one. All I told her to do, she took 8 strokes and 9 strokes on the one before. I said, I want you to take 7 strokes and 8 strokes. So take 1 stroke off each lap. All right. Now, the important thing when coaches, for most coaches is they don't want the kids to slow down when they're working on technique. All right. They don't want the intervals to slow down. And that's the biggest complaint that I get from parents. So I said, okay, you're going to take 7 strokes and 8 strokes is your goal. So we'll take a look at it. See the little bit of extra length in each one of the strokes, just a little bit more time spent in the line. Nothing drastic. Nothing. There's no huge difference here. This is just thinking of something, a goal, and that what are all the different things you have to do to accomplish that goal? And so letting the athlete figure these things out and then asking them a series of questions afterwards. I'm gonna go ahead and I tried to stop it before the data comes up. And so I asked her all the questions, easier, harder, you know, blah, 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 and all that stuff. And then I told her what she did. So there's the comparison. The first one is on the left. The second one is on the right. She improved her breakout points. So she went a little bit farther on the underwater on both of them. Is that bad or good? That's good, right? Okay. The first split was a 17.8 compared to the 18.5. The second split was 19.7 compared to the 20.5. 7 strokes, 8 strokes, a second and a half faster with 2 strokes less. And when I told her what the time was, 37.6, I got the thing that we all want as teachers. She couldn't believe that she did what she just did because it was way easier. And so hopefully this plays, sticking a little bit. But the side-by-side, here they are. This is one stroke difference, a second and a half faster. This is the thing about breaststroke, is that less is more. If you can teach kids how to stay in the line better, if you can teach them the importance of their underwaters, teach them the importance of the integrity of the line, they can get better. So to challenge this athlete to not go slower in practice, but to take maybe one stroke off per length, look at the difference. There she's done. And she's got another stroke on the other one. And this is real world practical application. And this is why I'm so excited with the app, because I'm using it in my teaching and I'm letting the kids figure it out. And I'm challenging them to a point that if they improve one of the aspects, that's their standard now. So, you know, this 37.6, she's not allowed to go any slower. Now she's got to go 7.7 or 6.7. And so it becomes more and more and more and more intense, to the point that one of the students this weekend owes me 50 push-ups because it was 10 push-ups each time that he didn't do it exactly right. And so if he had to do them at home, but it's one of those things that you want to get in their heads. I think, you know, that when I was teaching in the endless pool, it was if they did something wrong, then their parents got to decide what chores they had to do when they got home. So it's a little different here. But it is so important that we have standards in everything we do that I'm so excited about how to teach using this data and using the app, because it is art mixed with real world sort of stuff. And these kids, I had an 11-year-old this weekend that was understanding the difference between the breakouts, the length, where to add kick and things like that. And somebody says, well, this app would be great for my seniors. Imagine that you had the entire career of someone that ended up being a great swimmer from 10-year-old to 20-year-old. And you had all of that progression, because man, if I had it, you would see, you know, at 10-year-old, I was horrible. And at 18, I was one of the fastest in the world. So the thing is that if you had that, then you would know not to press someone at 10 years old to swim harder, but teach them how to swim. So, see, somebody's doing something here. Let me see if I can grab that back. Okay, thanks, whoever that was. Turned that off. I haven't seen that one before. Barbara, go. We're at an hour. I'm sorry, everybody. Breaststroke's tough. Yeah.
What I was going to say, and I'm replying to Monty's question, the final one there, just patience. This is not 1 hour of a lesson. This is like hours and hours of repetition. Each time you bring them back to the water, you review and you go over everything. Breaststroke just takes a lot of time and a lot of patience. That would be my 2 cents.
So may I ask, are you trying to just get through one of those steps or half of one of those steps in one-hour session?
For me, I mean, the line is fairly easy to teach, the concept. The kick can take many hours. I'm talking masters here. Kids may be a little bit different, but masters, especially if they have a wonky foot, you can spend 4, 5, 6 practices trying to get the kick right. And I usually don't move on until they get the kick. Anyway.
It is without a doubt. You know, you think about the, oh, fantastic, Australia. Good morning. Good morning. Yeah, I work with Wayne Goldsmith. And he's in Brisbane, and it's always like, what time are we getting together? But it is without a doubt. We are limited. We all think that there's a timeline that we're in front of. And kids have the toughest timeline because they have every season they're supposed to perform. But the idea that you only have to be great once if you're a kid, you know, really. And when that is, I don't know, depending on the person. You know, for me, it was always the goal of being great once at the Olympics. But for most kids, it's like, be great once so that you get a scholarship to college. You know, show who you can be and someone will give you money to teach you how to have a better life. You know, that's where, thanks, Alex. That's where this is. So being great at 10, 12, 14, 16, you got to be great at 17 and 18. If you're a kid, if you're at college, you got a few years there. If you turn pro, then you're probably got to be great all the time. But for those of us that are master swimmers, we got nothing but time, you know? And so to sit back and take time, you know, if you learn, I think one of the greatest things I ever heard about master swimming is the goal is to get slower, slower. And so, you know, you're just trying to hang on. And the better technique is we start to do this in our life. If the technique goes better, then we're just playing out and we're staying the same. That's progress. It's progress, you know? So Steve, if you're still here, thank you so much as always. We'll be using more of your stuff as we go through the rest of the rest of the courses. Are you back now from Nicaragua?
Yes, I've been home for a week.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. How was it? Good surfing?
Unbelievable. Yeah, it was great.
Well, we're glad you're home safe. And next week, obviously, Barbara, we're doing an advanced breaststroke. Okay. Yeah. Get into more stuff and I'll try to finish in less than an hour, but man, it's tough. It's tough. So, thank you everybody. And, yeah, the app is the GoSwim app. Everything you saw today was straight out of the app. I just load videos into it. And, I got to tell you from a teaching perspective, I taught 4 hours this weekend, not a ton. I shot 150 videos. And all I do is tap the kid's name and they're automatically sent to them. The parents are sitting on the side watching the data come through as the lesson's going on. It is working so well. I'm very proud of the last 5 years of work that we did to get to this point. 5 years. And it's working really, really well. So if you're a coach, film your kids at practice, you tap on it, they get it. You just pull your phone out of your pocket. It can't be any easier than that. And we will do a Zoom in the next week to week and a half, strictly on the app. I'll show all the different use cases. And so that way everybody will know. So the kids need to register, but if you're a coach, reach out to me. We're going to get pretty aggressive on getting kids in, but you want to be connected with them because it's protection, privacy protection, data protection. We go through it all. We have a privacy attorney on retainer for us. So we make sure all the kids are protected. It protects the kids. It protects you as a coach. All the data and all the video are private. And so we've gone all the extra miles to make sure that everything is taken care of. And all you do is film and talk over the video and they get it. So anyway, more to come. Again, thanks everybody. I will see you next Tuesday if you can make it. All right. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Baron. Thanks, Steve. See you, Monty. Bye, Lana.
Look at my comment to you.
What's that?
Look at my comment to you.
There's too many. Where is it? Yes, exactly. Nice. Beautiful. Thanks, Monty. Good to see you. I'll see you again soon, okay?
I hope so. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.